All right, so we've gotten somewhere along the way. Whatever you've got with your notes, you probably have this little star thingy. The star thingy means you haven't saved lately or since you've made a change last. So you always want to hit save, and now it's gone. See, save, gone. Thank you. So that's very, very helpful. So see, even if I go in here, I put a space, it's like, hey, you've been saved since the space was out. I'm like, okay, thanks, guy. So if over on the left you see an ASV file, don't let that freak you out. It's just an autosave, and it's just a bunch of garbage, and I'm not exactly sure why it's there, but MATLAB seems to like it. Just ignore it. So the next thing that we're going to look at is matrices. The mat part of MATLAB means matrices. It's very, very, very good at dealing with matrices. Actually, whenever MATLAB sees 4, it converts it to a 1x1 matrix that has a 4 in it, which is why it's really, really, really important to be good at matrices to use MATLAB. So as you can see here, there's a whole bunch of different ways to create a row vector. Row vectors. So I'm going to start my little section. Row vectors. You might wonder why I keep creating sections instead of just going to the next line. The reason is because if I come up here, if I say run section, it only runs what's in that entire section. If I didn't divide things out into sections, every time I hit run section, it would run the entire code. If it's not turning colors whenever you go, it's probably because you're not putting a space after. See, if I don't put a space after the 2% signs, I don't get row vectors. So anyway, just something to think about. So say I wanted to make the numbers 1 through 4. I could create a vector by going 1, 2, 3, and 4. And I've got a row vector, 1 through 4. Woohoo! All right. I could also say, I want to go from 1 to 4. And that will actually work. So I'm going to run my, I'm going to start with CLC clear, because it's always kind of nice manners, helps me get some clean stuff. So there I go. I have 1 through 4. And I have 1 through 4, so there's at least 2 different ways to do 1 through 4. Let's see, what else can we do? Oh, I can put that in brackets. Bracket 1 through 4, close bracket. That works. I can do bracket 1, 2, 3, 4. That works. I can do 1, 2, 3, 4. That works. Well, that works. I can say 1, comma 2, comma 3, with no comma 4, get the same thing. MATLAB is phenomenally versatile. This would make you so happy. This is going to be a little weird, but this works too. I can get 1 to 2, and then 3 to 4. I can go 1, and then 2 to 4. Next, let's call it the next thing. Anyway, you don't have to write all these down. I'm just letting you know. Maybe you do have to write them down. I don't know. Do what you think you need to do to learn the material, but basically I can go all different kinds of ways and come up with the vectors 1 through 4. Isn't that pretty? It's amazing. What else we got? I can assign a certain sequence by hand. So let's do more stuff. I need to have better titles in this. More row vectors. So I can say I specifically want a vector that says 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. Make sense? You're like, well, those are all the odd numbers. Well, as a matter of fact, I can tell MATLAB specifically to do that. So I can say start at 1, skip by 2s, and go to 9. And I get the exact same thing. So I'm going to make a comment. See how I can make a comment even within the same line as I'm typing? So I can say start at 1, skip by 2s, go to 9. Start at 1, skip by 2s, go to 9. All right. Make sense? Okay, so there's a couple of questions that are embedded here. See if you can figure this out. So what are the outputs for these? So I'm going to copy them over to my notes. I mean, you can still print this out. I just like to have my own notes that I wrote as I went along. So what are the outputs for these? So think about what you expect that to do. Okay? So take a minute again. Seriously, don't just like blindly just keep paying attention or not paying attention. You really want to stop and you want to think about this and you want to make it make sense. So you think about this first one. That means I start at 1, I skip by 10s until I get to 3. Does that make any sense? Surprisingly, no, shouldn't make too much sense, but if you just want to see it, you could say z equals 1 to 10 to 3. It's going to start at 1. and it's going to add 10 to 1 until it gets to 3, and then it's going to stop, which means it isn't going to go anywhere. Because it wants to write a 1, then it would write an 11, but it's already past the end point, so it just stops. That's kind of a trick question, I guess. What about the next one? 10, minus 1, and 1. So it's going to start at 10. It's going to subtract 1 until it gets down to 1. Make sense? All right, the next one. He starts at 1. He increases by a tenth until he gets to 2. So you're going to see 1, 1.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, all the way up to 2. All right? So that's pretty cool. There's another way that you can set things up. You can say, I want a certain number of linearly spaced elements. So I can say I want 4 elements linearly spaced from 0 to 10. And notice this is a big, big deal. This is different. This is different. How is this different? This is different. Linspace is different. So linearly spaced, so if I say linspace, it's start, end, number of elements. Okay? So if I say linspace, I don't know, 1, 2, 5, and I want 12. I want 7 elements. It's gonna go 1 to 5. See, 1 to 5, and I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 elements. Why do I ever need to do that? You have no idea. Use this thing all the time. Any function that's in MATLAB is clearly there because somebody needed it and needed it enough to make it part of a function, and not just a function for them, but a function for every MATLAB user on the planet to use. So linspace. This is something that people always miss on the test. So since I just said that, this is something people always miss on the test, then really what you should do is get out your little pencil and paper and be like, potential test question, linspace, 1, 5, 7. Yay! Okay. What else we got? I don't know. Oh, log space. Linspace and log space are different. There we go. Log space. So if I do, it's really a start power to an end power with number of elements, which basically means if I said log space 1, 3, and 7, where would it start? So it actually starts, I'll make another little line here, starts at 10 to the start power, ends at 10 to the end power. Make sense? So when I do log space 1, 3, 7, kind of cool here, right? So if I go 1, 3, 7, that means I'm actually starting, I'm going 10 to the 1 to 10 to the cubed with 7 elements. So I'm starting 10 to the 1 is 10 to 1,000. With 7 elements. Okay, so 7 evenly spaced elements from 10 to 1,000. And if I run that, that's what you should see. Now see, it looks really funny? That is the scientific notation. If you want to make it look like it makes a little bit more sense, do format bank. Remember that puts 2 decimal places on anything, like formats it like it's money. And then now it's a little bit easier to see. So you can see I start at 10, and I go up to 1,000. Kind of makes sense? All right, so if you think that makes sense, so I'm going to say create 5 linearly spaced elements starting at, I don't know, give me a number, 8, and ending at, I don't know, 73. All right. And then once you got that, then create, I don't know, 4 logarithmically spaced elements starting at 1 and ending at 1,000. Okay. Now, something I didn't necessarily mention, but these are logarithmically spaced. So that means that there's more at the bottom than you have at the top. In fact, before we do these things down here, going to plot x. Look at that. So this is what we have. In fact, don't get too excited about what we're doing here, but there we go. All right. So these are my logarithmically spaced elements. So there was my 10. Is that where it started at? Yeah, started at 10. And then it goes up to 1,000. Let me do one more thing to make it even prettier. There we go. So it goes like this. So logarithmically spaced elements mean is literally, well, logarithmically spaced, it's your exponential curve. If I was going to graph my linear space, and I'll just call that something different. And again, don't worry too much about what this plotty stuff is. I'm just doing it for funsies at the moment. Take this one out. So now plot. Oh, come on, girl. So see, the linearly space gives you linearly a line like you would expect. So everything is evenly distributed. I'm not going to plot one at a time. The logarithmically spaced one gives you that curve right there. Okay? So anyway, back to the point. See if you can write the code to create 5 linearly spaced elements from 8 to 73 and then create 4 logarithmically spaced elements from 1 to 1,000. And again, don't just see like, I'm just going to wait for her to do it. You have to take an active learning approach because the way this class is set up, if you're just like not paying attention unless you're like just the gift of all to programming, you're going to get stuck. And even if you're good at programming, other programming languages don't necessarily have the same kind of functionality as MATLAB. So you do want to practice and you do want to get good at it. All right, so if I'm going to create 5 linearly spaced elements from 8 to 73, why did I call it A? No particular reason. But linearly spaced Linspace. Starting at 8, ending at 73, and there are 5 of them. Starting at 8 to 73, there are 5 of them. Now for this one, it's clearly a log space. On the test, people tend to do this. Why is this wrong? Okay. Does this, first of all, does it start at 1? No. Does it go to 1,000? No. It goes to infinity. So I'm going to copy this. I'm going to show you why this is wrong. Okay. So, anyway, make it bigger. Remember what this is doing is this is a power. So this is really going from 10 to the 1 to 10 to the 1,000. Spaced by 4, or not spaced by 4, but with 4 elements. That's not what you wanted. Okay, this is not what you wanted. You didn't want to go from 10 to the 1 to 10 to the 1,000. You wanted to go from 10 to 1,000. So you have to remember, well, 10 to the what? I mean, you don't want to go from 10 to 1,000. You want to go from 1 to 1,000. So you have to remember, well, 10 to the what is 1. You got to, like, drag that brain up and you go, oh, 10 to the 0 was 1, and then to the 1,000, that's 10 to the 3. So you're going to do log space 0 to the 3 with 4 elements, and that should get you what you want. So 0 to 3 with 4 elements. And there we go. And see, look how pretty it is. It's like, it's pretty. I don't know. I like it. It's logarithmically spaced. I don't know what else you could want. Anyway, that's kind of fun. So now you can make row vectors. All right, so next we're going to look at, operations with row vectors. Basically just stuff that you can do with row vectors. None of this should really come to a shock. If I give you x from 1 to 5, so this would be like kind of a really easy test question. I'd be like, what is the output of the following lines of code? And it would say x goes from 1 to 5 and y goes x plus 3. So knowing little to nothing, or maybe you know tons, about programming, what would you expect the output to be? I'd be like, okay, well, first of all, I'm going to clear this up. You can say, well, the first thing that's going to happen is, in fact, let me go ahead and I'm going to write this down. So I got this. Okay, well, first of all, we're going to make this bigger because that's apparently what I need to do. So this guy is going to go x goes from 1 to 5. So it's going to look like this. And then y is going to go x plus 3. So probably not surprisingly, everything that I see in x, I'm going to add 3 to. So I'll have 3, 5, 6, 7, 8. Wait, I can't add. 1 plus 3 is 4. Yay, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Like that. Got it? All right. So that's what I expect to see. And I'll go ahead and run it in MATLAB and see what it gets me. So yeah, there's my 1 to 5. And there's my 4 to 8. Make sense? All right. So adding two row vectors should not be shocking. You can use the subtraction. You can use it for multiplication. So, you know, if I have degrees, I can just copy and paste because I'm lazy. So if I have degrees, I can if I just have a certain number of ones there. I can say that radians are degrees times pi over 180. And there I got my little ratio of degrees to radians. And it's all kinds of fancy. I can perform functions on all elements of vectors. So in addition to multiplying or subtracting, I can actually say, well, now that I have all those in radians, in fact, I'd rather do that than what I have in my notes. Now that I have all those in radians, let's go ahead and find the sine. So whatever is equal to sine of those radians. And that was kind of boring. Oh no, there it started to change. Yeah. So let's make this something I actually know. So I know the sine of 30, 45, 60. In fact, I also know the sine of 0. All right. So you may have guessed that MATLAB works in radians. So the sine I expect to get, the sine of 0 is 0. And it's 1 half and whatever square root of 2 over 2 is. And then I expect to see square root of 3 over 2. And then 1. So I expect to see answers that look kind of like that. So I'm going to convert into radians, and then I'm going to take the sine of it. And there I've got my 0.5, square root of 2 over 2, square root of 3 over 2, and 1. So yay! MATLAB works! Woohoo! Alright. Chapter 2. What else we got? So dot products. We did talk about this in the pre-class lecture thing, the getting started lecture. That is your element by element multiplication. Another way to think about it is to think about it like a dot product. So again, it's really standard issue kind of test question. What would you expect to see? And you go like, all right, well, I've seen this before. This is kind of like a dot product. Or it's that element by element multiplication she was talking about. So if I have this guy here, if I multiply, it's going to be each one multiplied by the similar one. So I expect to see it's going to be 1 times 5, and then 2 times 6, and then 3 times 7. So I expect to see 5, 12, and 21. All right. So let's do that. 5, 12, 21. Amazing. Not shocking. All right. What happens if I do this? And you're like, okay, what if I just multiply x times y? What do you expect to see? So I'm going to write it out. So I want to multiply 1, 2, and 3. And I want to do my matrix, regular old matrix multiplication with 5, 6, and 7. So what's going to happen? It's going to be sad, right? Because this is a 1 by 3 matrix. And this is a 1 by 3 matrix. I can't multiply a 1 by 3 by a 1 by 3 because the inner dimensions don't match. So if I go ahead and try to do that, I try to say x times y, it's going to yell at me since the inner dimensions don't match. I'm like, yeah, I knew that. That same element by element stuff holds for the divide and for the power. We've already talked about that, but here's just a review. I can say x to the y. I can say any of this stuff. So if you want to experiment with this, you always want to make sure that you run this by and see what you can get. So I'd expect to see 9 divided by 3, 4 divided, 12 divided by 4. Let me put these in their own little sections so they don't all run at the same time. But I expect to see 9 divided by 3, 12 divided by 4, and 18 divided by 9. Yep. And then 1 to the 5, 2 to the 4, and 3 to the 3. So again, for all of these, you should be able to predict the outcome before you run the code. If you can't predict the outcome before you run the code, you're not doing it right. You're not going to learn. You're going to fail the test. Don't fail the test. Feeling the test is sad.